impact of a monastery. What is monastery? What are the contributions that monastery has done in the spread of Christianity as well as in the spread of education? And so next thing that we are going to discuss is about the monks, monasteries and their impact, that is the impact that they have left, they have affected, that is the meaning of it, how they have contributed in the field of religion as well as in the field of education, secular education. So as we have seen in our previous classes that monks were, they came from the priest group. In the Christianity there were priests, two groups of priests were there. Number one group remained with the people, serving them, teaching them, performing the rituals, rites and rituals. So they were with the people directly, whereas second group of priests, they wanted to have a secluded life means separated life. Now from where they separated? They were separated from the group of the people, that is from the social living. They separated themselves from the social living, and so they kept themselves aloof. Now why they kept aloof themselves? The reason is that they may be able to serve the Lord or serve the religion with more effective manner, and that's why they separated. And so once they separated, they were tied up with the vows of poverty, vows of chastity and vows of obedience. These are the three vows that the monks had to take. Okay, that is on page number 21. So what is this vows? Vows, V-O-S, vow. Vow is a promise. It's not a vow, it's a vow. Vow is the promise. Promise to whom? Promise to the Lord. Promise to Jesus. That is directly, let me tell it. So it was the promise to their God. And so what they have to take? They said, I am going to be like this. What were that? Vows of poverty. A life of poverty. They don't have to live. It's not that they are very poor. No. But the sense of poverty or the attitude of poverty has to be practiced. And they are not to own property, for that matter. They don't have to own. They need not own. They were away from the family, no bank account, not much of property things, especially luxurious things like fine bed. Today we sleep in the very nice, fine, soft mattresses. Okay, and we enjoy the sleep. Whereas these monks, they have to sleep on the mat. Sleep on the mat, hard mat. We have nice clothes, whereas they have to wear a shabby cloth. Hope you have seen how our monks, our priests, our sadhus, they wear. That is not very attractive dress. A cotton linen cloth, single color. And so whatever the color is, So that is, and they don't have to have the property in their name and all that. Next one is the vow of chastity. Vow of chastity. What is this vow of chastity? Vow of chastity, the word itself says chaste. Chaste meaning pure. Chaste meaning pure. Now, in what sense? Moral pure. Morally, you have to be sound. Morally, you have to be sound. And separate them. Keep yourself away from any pleasures, especially the physical pleasures that people enjoy in the marital life. That physical relationship with the opposite sex, they have to avoid. They have to avoid. So they need not marry. They remain chaste. They remain pure, untouched. And so they have to take this vow that I am going to remain chaste throughout my life for the cause of the service of God and the people. That is the meaning. Next one is the vow of obedience. Vow of obedience. That means they have to obey whatever the superior says, whatever the master says. Now, what is the meaning? What is the, who is the master of the monk? Master of the monk is abbot. The who is the mistress of the nuns? See, abbess. Abbess. Okay, remember that. And so they have to obey the, their superiors wherever they are needed. They wear their whatever they have to do, they have to say. It is not that I cannot say, oh, if I have to be a monk and I have to say yes to everything. Yes to everything. Whenever required, whatever work I am assigned, I have to do. I cannot say no. So you have been transferred to, from this place to this place. I cannot say no, I will not go. I like this place, so I will not go. No. In that, in this vow of obedience, you have to go by all means. You don't have to question. You don't have to question why and how. All that is away from this. It's not possible to obey the church and the monastic rule. That is the reason. So this is what the things. So where they were living, so monks used to live in the monastery and the nuns in the nunneries. The impact of monasteries have become major center of education. That is center of education. That means they started. See, those days there were not printed book, no printed book. There was handwritten manuscripts, and so they had to collect, and that is not available. Maybe one copy or two copies hardly, and so that has to be kept. So they started collecting books. This is how the library came. You know, this system of education, the end game. And so they were teaching people. They were the most important thing that the monasteries did was to set up libraries. See that, and that were rare and expensive books. Okay, next one is that they also taught people better ways of farming. They had enough of land, and so they used to cultivate for themselves by their own. So they don't have to go to the market for vegetable, to buy vegetable and all that. No. Everything is there in their field. They have to do, they have to work. They have to work. One of the work was to work in the farm, gardening, farming. So that is the work they had. What was that? Prayer. Then comes work. Prayer and work. And surely, take care of the sick, the children, teach them. So teaching, okay, praying, working and teaching. So these were the work, three works they had. So mainly, so they taught people. So they were not only taught books, they also taught how to cultivate the crops, different types of crops, and how to look after the farms, how to take care, how to establish farms. The monasteries possessed vast stretch of land where they carried out agricultural work and taught people how to transform wilderness to the cultivable land. So wilderness, the unfertile land, the unfertile land they had to turn into fertile land. How? Put the manure and all that to us. So there is a process. Soon the popularity of the monasteries spread in whole of Europe. People began to donate land to different places. So they had to many houses, many communities they started forming. And so they donated. People came forward with their property, with their land, with the things, and this is how the monasteries is developed. Okay, so dear student, this is what I wanted to tell you about this, and then we are going to conclude history section. Surely, according to the syllabus, we don't have civics. Next video that I am going to make and upload is about the geography, the first lesson of geography. Till then, see. Bye. Thank you.